I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. I wish I could break all the chains holding me.
In 1862, the Washington-Georgetown Railroad received its charter and began horse-drawn streetcar service with segregated cars from Wisconsin and M. Northwest to the Capitol and then on to the Navy Yard. African Americans were required to ride up front with the driver. Sojourner Truth, the former slave who was a prominent abolitionist and women's rights advocate, immediately challenged the company by refusing to vacate whites-only streetcars. She complained to the company president, who ordered the restrictions removed, fearing the loss of the company charter. Senator Charles Sumner, a lifelong advocate of equal rights for African Americans, moved quickly to prevent any future attempts at discrimination by seeking and winning a charter amendment prohibiting segregation on the Washington-Georgetown streetcars. Sumner shepherded a bill through Congress in 1865 that prohibited segregation for all District of Columbia streetcar companies, and President Abraham Lincoln signed the bill on March 3, 1865. A short month later, Lincoln's funeral car traveled those same streetcar tracks up Pennsylvania Avenue. The fight to enforce the desegregation law began. Truth forced the issue several more times, including a case where a conductor attempted to physically remove her. Truth reported the incident to the company, who fired the conductor. Truth also pressed assault charges in court, sending a message to all that the desegregation law would be enforced. Catherine Brown made history when she purchased a ticket in 1868 in Alexandria, bound for Washington, and attempted to board a Washington and Georgetown streetcar in the whites-only section. She was refused boarding and sued. The case went to the U.S. Supreme Court, which ruled in her favor in 1873. In 1876, the tide turned. In order to become president, Rutherford B. Hayes made a deal to end Reconstruction, the guarantee that former slaves would be given economic opportunity and equal rights, backed up by federal troops. Throughout the South, voting rights were revoked, lynchings became widespread, and Jim Crow laws, laws that segregated races, began to be passed throughout the South. In 1883, the Supreme Court overturned a law that prohibited discrimination by corporations and individuals. Homer Plessy, a man classified under Louisiana law as black, agreed to act as a test case against Jim Crow streetcar segregation laws in New Orleans. Plessy's case went to the Supreme Court in 1896. The court infamously ruled that separate but equal was constitutional. Washington, D.C. was soon targeted for Jim Crow laws. But after the turn of the century, young ministers like S.L. Carruthers of Galbraith AME Church on 6th Street Northwest and Walter H. Brooks of the 19th Street Baptist Church began organizing against Jim Crow in the district. However, the circle around D.C. began tightening, as Virginia required separate cars on railroads in 1900. The city of Alexandria passed a Jim Crow streetcar law in 1901, and in 1906, Virginia passed a statewide Jim Crow streetcar law. Emboldened segregationists imposed Maryland law on Colonel Perry Carson, the undisputed political leader of African Americans in the city, and forced him to ride in a segregated streetcar while still within the city limits. The push by segregationists spawned a new line of thinking among African Americans around the country, who no longer felt the self-help philosophy of Booker T. Washington was effective. In 1905, Washingtonian W.H.H. Hart joined W.E.B. Du Bois and others to form the Niagara Movement, urging African Americans to take a more aggressive stand for full equality. The back-and-forth battle continued in 1906. And future Mississippi Senator James Vardaman called for Jim Crow streetcars in D.C., at the same time as W.H.H. Hart was testing Maryland's segregated lines. Hart won his court case, but was awarded only 1 cent in a sign of the times. By 1908, Congressman Jim Heflin of Alabama was so emboldened, he introduced a bill for Jim Crow streetcars in the district, and the following month shot an African American on a streetcar. He was applauded in the press for his actions. Even so, immediately after this brazen attack, the Washington Ministers Union succeeded in getting Jim Crow signs removed from streetcars and trains while they were within the District of Columbia in 1908. In 1909, Washingtonians Mary Church Terrell and Francis Grimke joined W.E.B. Du Bois and others to form the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, NAACP, and set about the task of fighting against the racist attacks and for full equality. Then in 1911, another congressman, Simon Roddenberry of Georgia, attacked and beat an African-American on a streetcar because the man was sitting beside him. The calls were again renewed for Jim Crow cars in the district. But perhaps the worst affront happened in 1912, when Woodrow Wilson was elected president. Wilson praised D.W. Griffith's racist film, Birth of a Nation, and promptly set about segregating federal government offices, with separate work areas, bathrooms, drinking fountains, and cafeterias. The calls for Jim Crow streetcars in the district escalated, and in 1915, U.S. Representative Frank Clark, chair of the House District Committee, sent a Jim Crow streetcar bill to the House floor. Civil rights leaders continued to resist, but tensions were reaching the boiling point. In 1919, World War I had just ended. Returning troops faced high unemployment, and returning African-American soldiers, having just fought for their country, faced segregated housing, jobs, theaters, and restaurants in the District of Columbia. The single biggest holdout against Jim Crow were the streetcar lines. Then, on July 19, 1919, police detained then released an African-American man after questioning him about an attack on a white woman. Drunken soldiers and sailors heard about the man's release and began pulling African-Americans off streetcars and beating and shooting them. Reading between the racist headlines of that time, tell us what happened next. In a racist editorial, lamented the loss of alleged subservience by Washington, D.C. African Americans. The Times went on to condemn violence by blacks while making excuses for whites. But the sentiments of African Americans in Washington may have been summarized best in this letter to the NAACP's Crisis newspaper.
The Washington riot gave me a thrill that comes once in a lifetime. At last, our men had stood up like men. I stood up alone in my room and exclaimed aloud, "Oh, I thank God! Thank God!" The pent-up horror, grief, and humiliation of a lifetime, half a century, was being stripped away from me.
The ferocity of African-American resistance to the attacks by white soldiers and sailors, and the counterattacks using the streetcar system to penetrate their strongholds, shocked the segregationists. While Jim Crow persisted in Washington, D.C. for another 30-plus years, after the Streetcar War, there was never another serious attempt to impose Jim Crow on Washington streetcars. The battle for equal rights in Washington, D.C. was poised to move from defense to offense.
I wish you could know what it means to be me.